Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, the Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to have a family meeting, if you will. So today's message is primarily to believers. I'm talking blood-washed, genuinely saved, born-again Christians, not pagan Christians. But even if you are one or you don't believe in Jesus, hang around. Because by the end of this lesson, I'm trusting God that you will want to join our family, the family of God. So the topic is small deeds, big deal. Small deeds, big deal. And the case study is the Corinthian church. And our short reading is 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We are going to start from verse 17 and stop at 34. 1 Corinthians 11, 17 to 34. But before we start to unpack what the Holy Spirit has for us today, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Dear sweet Lord Jesus, we honor you. Blessed Holy Spirit, we hallow you. Be thou exalted, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your love for the world. Thank you for your love, especially to your bride, the church. And Lord, we ask, as we are going to talk about this very important, critical area in the body of Christ, help us, O Lord, to see where we are getting it wrong. And Lord, let this message fire us up to make us changers, different makers that will make difference in different Bible fellowships and house churches that we may be worshiping at. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our foundation text is the book of Job. I believe the theologians believe is the oldest book in the Bible. Chapter 36, verse 5, the book of Job. Chapter 36, verse 5. Behold, God is mighty, but despiseth no one. He is mighty in strength and wisdom. God is mighty and despises no one. He is mighty in strength and wisdom. What does he's telling us is, as powerful, as mighty as God is, he does not despise anybody. He does not. Now, there's a background story to our topic today, but time will not permit me. But if you read your short reading, you will understand what the whole background is about. So the church in Corinth was supposedly coming together to eat the Lord's Supper, the communion. However, their gathering to observe the most sacred command became an occasion for sacrilegious behaviors. Why? Let's see what they were doing. Number one, they were sectional. Believers in the church at Corinth were reported to have sections or cliques, if you will, within the church. This is a small deal that many would not have even noticed. Yet, to God, It's a big deal. It's a big sin before God. When believers, listen up, child of God, listen up if you're a believer. When believers divide into little groups, are you listening? Track with me. Based on race, socioeconomic status, education, culture, or any other dividing tool they may come up with. Watch this. We stick a knife at the heart of Jesus, who prayed that his disciples shall be one. That's in John 17, 21. We are not reading that. But that was one of the last prayers that Jesus prayed before he went into the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus said, by loving one another, the world will know you are my disciples. That's in John 13:35. We are not reading that. Listen up. It is a command. It's not an opinion. It's not a suggestion. It is a command for every genuine believer to go out of their comfort zone to reach others within the body of Christ. Get to know them. This doesn't mean you must go into friendship, relationship with everybody. No. But people must be comfortable around you. You must be approachable and friendly to the members of the household of faith. Do you know? Some people, if you don't attend their church, and when I say church, is not in the context of the Bible, the brick and mortar that they call church, which is just a building, because in biblical context, Jesus said, we are the temples. The believers, we are the temples, you see. The church is an organism. Each believer is a church. But people have misused that language today. Pagans, well, you can't blame them. What do they know? So they call a building a church. It's like calling a house a family. No. The people inside the house makes it a family, not the building, you see. But some people, because you don't fellowship in the same building where they fellowship, they won't talk to you. Seriously. And they call themselves Christians. I wonder the Bible they read it. Or even some people within the same body, they go to the same building to fellowship, the same house church to fellowship. They don't even talk to one another. Because maybe she's black, he's white, she's green, she's purple. What nonsense, you see. That is a big sin before God. As a believer, if indeed you're a genuine believer. It was Pastor Billy Graham. He said, he asked the woman, are you a Christian? He said, oh no, thank God I'm not. I'm a Baptist with a capital B, you see. A Baptist is not a Christian, according to him, according to that man. And I said, you know what? He's right. He is not a Christian. Because if he was a Christian, he would know that there's no Baptist in heaven, there's no Methodist in heaven, there's no Lutheran in heaven, you see. Let's go to James 2, verse 1, and then we jump to verse 9. James chapter 2, we read verse 1, and then we go to verse 9. My brethren, that is, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. Verse 9. But if you show partiality, you commit sin. Did you hear that? That's what Jesus said. I didn't say that. You commit sin. If your preference of dealing with people is based on race, economic status, education, or the same building where you worship, the Bible says you commit sin. you see, and are convicted by the law as transgressors. Guess what? If you are indeed a genuine believer, because a believer will not be condemned with the world according to 1 Corinthians, but if you are a child of God and you are sectioning the way you operate in the body of Christ, watch out. You are writing a letter to trouble. I'm telling you, God will come after you and he will spank you. Oh yeah. He will spank you as your daddy, because he has not called us to sectionalism. Sections bring wedges and breed tensions. Be the game changer. As I'm talking to you, as I'm pointing at you, I'm pointing to myself too. Sections bring wedges and breed tensions. Be the game changer. Moving on. The second thing that the church at Corinth was doing that grieved the Holy Spirit was that they were selfish. Oh, we could have a whole lesson on that topic, because that is the cancer that is eating the world right now, especially in the United States. Everybody is me. So listen up. The church at Corinth was said to be composed of selfish individuals who looked out for number one. You see, looked out for me, myself, and I, rather than the other person. People brought their dinners to the meeting to eat before having the Lord's Supper. At the time, people would bring their food. So after they finished their own dinner that they brought from their homes, then they will have the Lord's Supper. Those who brought food to the meeting will enjoy their food without any care to see if there was anyone who did not have anything to eat. You see, that was how horrible, how terrible it was at Corinth. Selfishness, listen up, is the work of the flesh. Is nothing but the work of the flesh, and it is ugly to the bone. You haven't seen an ugly person until you see a selfish person. I'm telling you. There is nothing spiritual or good about selfishness. Listen up. Even the people of the world who don't even believe in Jesus, they can't even stand people who are too much into themselves. They can't. It's repulsive. It's repugnant. Seriously. Jesus gave us the perfect example through his life. He did not do anything for selfish reason. If you're a Christian, a Bible-believing Christian, go read your Bible. If there's one verse where Jesus served himself ahead of other people, or he did something for his own personal benefit ahead of his disciples, please send the Bible verse to me. Please. But I promise you, you're not going to find one, because he lived a selfless life. We have been commanded to pattern our lives after that of Jesus, to be self-focused or self-centered in the midst of other believers is to be breaking the golden rule. No one can love God with all their hearts and not love their brother or their sister in the Lord and others around them. We must be deliberate in looking for opportunities to serve God by sharing things with other believers, rather than be served and be a habitual taker. No, it's got to be mature, you see. Jesus said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." God could have used you to bless his sister, to meet up and rent. Don't expect that God will use that sister or another sister or brother in the body the same way. No. God may use them to rise up and be a prayer warrior for you in your own time of trouble, you see. But God, who commanded us to minister to one another, knows that we need to grow up together as believers. The world hates us already as believers. Seriously, because they hate Jesus. The world hates Jesus. And so they hate his disciples. So if you are just for yourself in the body, listen up. It's time to repent. It's a big sin. It may seem small to you, but listen, it's a big deal to God. I don't have many sisters in my life. I don't have many friends. But the few ones that God has placed in my life, oh my goodness, I cannot trade them for anything. I mean anything. And I hope I've been a blessing to them because we're talking friendship that have spanned over 12 or more years, you see. That's the way it should be. You should be somebody that a sister or a brother, if you are man to man, or a sister, woman to woman, in the body of Christ, can pick up the phone 3 o'clock in the morning and they're crying on the phone, what's going on? And they can talk to you. You can pray together. You can drive over and say, what's going on? You see. Not to put ourselves ahead of other people. No. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 3 to 4. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 3 to 4. And this is the story of Jonathan and David, one of the greatest examples of godly friendships in the Bible. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he, that is Jonathan, loved him, David, as his own soul, like his own brother. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him. Jonathan was a prince. He's the king's son, okay? So he took off his royal robe and gave it to David. Now, David didn't come from a rich family. Oh, no. And Jonathan gave his armor, even to his sword and his bow and his belt. He gave everything to David. And those were very expensive stuff that he gave to David. David didn't have anything to give him in return because he's from a poor family. But guess what? Some years down the road, David became the king and Jonathan had died. By that time, the only son, the only child that Jonathan had was lame in his feet, Mephibosheth. It was David that brought Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, from the middle of nowhere. He brought him into the palace and restored all the wealth of his grandfather, King Saul, back to him, you see. See how David, see how God used him to repay the goodness of what was done to him some years back, you see. Let's go to the gospel according to Luke chapter 5, verse 11. Luke 5, 11. So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. This is the story of Peter and his brother and the sons of Zebedee. They had tried fishing all night. Nothing happened. Well, fast forward, Jesus came and said, would you mind if I borrowed one of your boats and use it? Jesus went into Peter's boat And he used it as a podium to preach to people. And after that, Jesus asked them to throw their net into the water, and they caught large catch of fish, you see. And after that, Jesus said, "Follow me." And they left everything and followed Jesus. Now, if Peter had been selfish to say, "Listen up, I've been working all night and I didn't catch any fish, and you want to use my boat? Get off." There wouldn't have been any Peter in the Bible today. We still read about Peter. He has two Bible books written after his name, you see. He got more than he could ever bargain for by not being selfish. He didn't know he was talking to Jesus. No, you see. Selfishness is the road to uselessness. Helpfulness is the code to blessedness. I am going to stop and I will reverse. And then we say it together slowly. Let's go. Selfishness is the road to uselessness. Helpfulness is the code to blessedness. You want to be useless? Then be selfish. You want to be blessed? Then begin to help others. Moving on. The church at Corinth was not only sectional, not only selfish, they were also shaming by their behavior. The practice of people bringing their own food and eating it before the Lord's Supper inadvertently shamed those who did not have among the Corinthian Christians. Although this was not done intentionally, listen up, they didn't go out to say, "Oh, we are going to shame some people." No. Nevertheless, it did not remove the fact that the practice damaged some relationships in the Corinthian church. Listen up. Stay close. Watch me. We need to be sensitive in the church. We need to be sensitive in the body of Christ. As a genuine believer, we are not to be personally be involved in any behavior that will expose the poor among us. No. It's degrading. Is disgraceful to Jesus Christ. We are not to expose the poor among us to ridicule. No. Believers are supposed to cover one another. We are supposed to cover for one another, not cover for sin. No. But when somebody is in trouble, we all come together. We are all together in that trouble. When somebody is in need, we are all in need. Not for you to be driving off your Lexus or just be putting your nose in the sky because God has blessed your husband or God has blessed you to work in a big company and you can't be bothered about the brother in your fellowship, a Bible study group or your house church. That is nonsense. Seriously. We need to advocate against such ideas when it is raised by others who may not have a deep thought about the possible repercussions of the idea they are suggesting to a home church or Bible fellowship. For example, and this is really common among Christian sisters. "Oh, Mother's Day is coming. Let's all wear fuchsia pink and jade green, sun yellow or yellow whatever sun color for shoes." Who is asking you? Huh? Jesus? If you want to celebrate Mother's Day, praise God. But why don't you say, let everybody come in whatever color, let's be multicolor. Or come in white, black, blue, red, the primary colors, that everybody has at least one of those colors in their wardrobes. Why fusion pink? Why jet green? Who cares? Huh? Or the church or your home church or your fellowship, you have a small project that you want to do, and then you finish fellowship and you say, oh, we need $1,000 for this small project. So, Sister ABC, how much are you going to donate toward that project? That is nonsense. That is nonsense. Because not everybody in that Bible group may have money. You don't know what they are going through. So don't make it public. Announce it. Whoever is willing, if God has laid it on your heart, if they are genuine children of God, you won't have to beg them to donate towards the cause of the gospel. You won't have to beg them. Oh no. Philippians 1:27. Listen up. This is Apostle Paul speaking by the Spirit, and Jesus is saying the same thing to us today. Only let your conversation, that is your conduct, be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. That is, let it be worthy of the gospel of Christ. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Listen up. Whether Jesus appears in your lifetime or in my lifetime, or he doesn't, if he doesn't appear in our generation, maybe he's gonna call us home by the way of death or sleep, because believers don't die. Whether he appears in the sky now or later, let it be that he will look at you and hear of how you conduct yourself in the body of Christ, and he will see that you are standing fast in one spirit, striving together for the faith of the gospel, not for fashion. The church is not for fashion. In fact, the church is not for money collection. No. The church is primarily for believers to come together and grow together. Do we need money to preach the gospel? Absolutely. But is that the primary reason we come together as believers? No. No. So let's throw out all these trivia things about fashion, about money, and all that. Let's focus on the primary thing, which is to grow together in the faith. That is the main thing. Let's keep the main thing the main thing. Do not shame for his name or for his sake in his domain. Do not shame for his name or for his sake in his domain. What are the small deeds that were a big deal to God at the church at Corinth? They were sectional. This is the worldly way of forming friendships based on class. They were selfish. This is the ungodly practice of putting themselves before the other person. They were shaming. This is to be insensitive by participating in practices that will expose the poverty of others or failure to advocate against such practices. Now, as a believer, do you have your own clique within your Bible study group or home church? Huh? Do you? The root of such ungodly behavior is pride. Listen up. You can say, oh no, Josephine Zion, you got that wrong. I didn't get anything wrong. By pride comes strife, says the book of Proverbs. The root problem you have is pride, and God is against the proud, you see. Look for opportunities to break the barriers in your house church or Bible fellowship group. And when you are trying to break the barrier, Please don't let your first question be, oh, you don't look like you are from here. Where are you from? That is nonsense. It shows your ignorance. Just introduce yourself. My name is Josephine Zaire. What's your name? I've been looking at you. It's good to have you here. And then start talking. In no time, that person will volunteer that information where they come from. All right? That is how to break the ice. We need to be Christians, not only in heart, but also in our acts. Now, if you're a non-believer, listen. You have already been missing out on the greatest friendship you could ever have. And that is the friendship with Jesus Christ. To show how much he loved you, he died for you. Okay? So, for him to be your friend, you first have to surrender your life to him. Because he is first the savior of the world. Then ask him into your life and begin to obey his teachings by studying his word, the Bible. Okay? That's how you grow. And find a good home church or Bible fellowship where they believe in the Bible. And then begin to enjoy the friendship that you can have in Jesus. Now, if you are ready to do that, a link is coming up as soon as I finish praying. Follow that link. We meet you there. Father, thank you that you have shown us your heart. Give us the grace to go practice. Help us, Holy Spirit. Deliver us from the works of the flesh. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.